Hello and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about what's new in the Postgres 16 Query Planner. This is a blog post by David Rowley, and David kind of knows what he's talking about since he's been one of the main contributors to planner improvements in Postgres 16. In this blog post on the Citus Data blog, David describes some of his own work in Postgres 16, as well as the work of other people in the Postgres community. Now, this is a long post. There's 10 different improvements that David lists here, but I'm going to try to cover this quickly, and I'm also going to editorialize the order here a little bit to make this easier to digest. We won't go through these in order, but rather I have four different categories of changes that we can talk about. We'll start with incremental sort, or reusing existing sort order. In Postgres, there's a concept called incremental sorts. This is something that has existed since Postgres 13. The idea behind incremental sorts is that if you are already getting sorted data, for example, from a B-tree index, you can avoid a lot of unnecessary work by having Postgres only incrementally sort for the extra sorting that needs to be done. For example, you're querying for two columns A and B, you have an index on column A, and so Postgres only needs to do the sorting for column B, saving a lot of work. Now, the change here in Postgres 16 is that when you have a select distinct, Postgres will be able to also do an incremental sort. When we look at the query plan here, this is very obvious. So if you see this improvement, what you would expect in terms of plan change is that now in 16, you will see this incremental sort node on your select distinct query, and this will very likely improve query performance. In this example, almost a 2x improvement. Another improvement that relates to sorted data is that aggregates that have an order by or distinct clause in them are now able to use pre-sorted data. So in this example, we have an index on A and B, and we're first grouping by A, and then a select, we're counting the number of distinct Bs. And so previously in Postgres 15, this would have had to do a sort. This sort is kind of hard to see in your explain plan, but you can know about this here when you look at the temp file read and written. So this means what Postgres was doing is it got all that data back and it did an additional sort in order to implement that distinct inside the count. In Postgres 16, however, that effort is gone. And because sorting on disk is expensive, we can see that there's about a 3x improvement here going from 15 to 16. Now, third, in the context of sorting, there's a change that relates to the planner doing a merge join. Merge joins work with sorted data, and so having a better understanding of incremental sorts in the merge join logic is actually very helpful. And so this is a bit more complex example. You can also see that David explicitly turns off hash joins and parallel query to show this example. And so we can see that in Postgres 15, Postgres did a merge join on top of the merge join sorted that output, versus in Postgres 16, Postgres is able to reuse the fact that the merge join output already has a particular sort order, as it can do an incremental sort on top of the merge join. Here, this is just a very small improvement, but I'm sure if you do joins with large amounts of data, this could have a nice benefit. Now let's talk a bit more about joins. So another improvement here is related to anti-joins. An anti-join usually happens when you use a not exists clause in your query. Now the implementation here has become a bit more flexible in Postgres 16 with the addition of write anti-joins. So this matters because in the case of a hash join, Postgres will build a hash table on one of the two tables being joined. And Postgres generally prefers to do this on the smaller table because that's going to be more efficient. But the problem is that previously in older releases, it always built the hash table on the table referenced inside that not exists. And so in Postgres 16, Postgres can now do either or by using a write anti-join. And so what you would see happen if Postgres makes a different choice here is that instead of seeing a hash anti-join, you would now see a hash write anti-join, and you would see the join order of the tables change. In this case, it's almost a 2x improvement in query runtime. Now talking about hash joins, since Postgres 11, we have the benefit of parallel hash joins. So this means that Postgres will use parallel workers to build a hash table that's shared between the different backends. And this can sometimes, you know, be quite a significant performance improvement. And so in Postgres 16, parallel hash join now supports full and write joins. So this means previously in Postgres 15, this would not have allowed the hash join to be inside of the parallel part of the query plan. But now we can actually see that we have a parallel hash full join that encompasses both of the parallel sequential scans. Now last, on the note of joins, sometimes you join things, but you don't actually need the data. For example, ORMs might unnecessarily join data. That's not needed. And so Postgres is now smarter about this. When you left join a table, but you're not actually using that table, Postgres will now be able to actually remove this. Here in this example, Postgres previously did a whole bunch of work for nothing, really, versus in Postgres 16, it's able to detect that it just needs to do a simple sequential scan of the table. This is very situational, but sometimes when you have bad queries that you don't even know about, maybe, this will save a little bit of time. Now, we're almost finished. There's two improvements that are relevant if you use window functions. The first one, again, relates to how you write your queries. When you write a window function, there's essentially a slower way and a faster way for Postgres to work on these functions. And this relates to what's either called the rows or the range mode. Many times we don't really think about this. We might write something simple like row number over and then a certain order. And so Postgres previously would do unnecessary work. And so Postgres 15 in this example would end up doing a lot more work, fetching a lot more rows, in this case 50,000 rows. Whereas in Postgres 16, Postgres knows that it can actually terminate this window function early, as it only needs to fetch 11 rows. Another improvement related to window functions is also related to not doing unnecessary work. And so in this case, this relates to certain types of window functions. So this behavior already existed for functions like count or rank or row number, but now in Postgres 16, if you're using functions like entile, cumulative distance, or percentage rank, these can now benefit from that same early termination of the window function. And as you can see here on Postgres 15, the window ACK node returned 50,000 rows, only to throw away most of them right afterwards, whereas in Postgres 16, Postgres can finish early and only process 500 rows. And again, of course, significant performance improvement, in this case about a 4x difference. Now last, there's two things that are kind of unrelated to everything we talked about so far. So the first one relates to Memoize. Memoize is essentially a way for Postgres to avoid repeated work. And I've been on both sides of the coin of finding Memoize useful or not useful. I've definitely seen plans where it caused some odd behavior. But generally speaking, it's a good performance improvement. And so now in Postgres 16, Memoize can also be used when there's a union all involved. So in this case, you can see we have two tables being unioned together, and then they're being joined to a third table. Now in Postgres 15, this query took 2000 milliseconds. In Postgres 16, it's down to a nice 280 milliseconds. The reason that is possible is because Postgres can memorize some of the values, and so it saves repeated work of having to look up the same data all over again in a nested loop. And now last, another situational improvement. What this here does is it avoids having to do the work of making the results unique if Postgres' other means of detecting its uniqueness. So in this case, we are looking for three columns, A, B, and C, and we're also returning the result as distinct on all these three columns we're looking for. And just by virtue of us looking up these fixed values, we know that the result of that scan is already going to be unique. So in Postgres 15, Postgres would unnecessarily do a unique node here, whereas in Postgres 16, Postgres is correctly able to say, as soon as I have a result, I'm good, I'm done. This can be a very nice improvement if you have queries written this way. To conclude, a lot of engineering work was done to get all of this into Postgres 16. And this is really a collaborative effort. Over the many years that Postgres has improved its planner, it's definitely shown that change is slow in the Postgres query planner, but that also means that we can usually trust new Postgres releases to be pretty stable in terms of plans. So that means when we upgrade, we would usually see an improvement, or at least the plan to stay stable between the releases. So I'm excited to upgrade to Postgres 16 to get these improvements, and I would encourage you to try them out. They're all enabled by default, so all you have to do is look at your query plan with explain, analyze, or auto-explain, and see these benefits for your workload. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.